Here at McCrindle, we believe that data tells a story. While we do work with numbers and statistics on a daily basis, we are also acutely aware that these numbers represent people's beliefs, opinions, and their values. And we value them because they paint a picture of the sentiments of a group of people and can help guide strategic thinking. Another way that statistics and stories can add real value is to a company's public relations campaign. And we've seen this many times. And so joining me today to discuss the power of research for public relations is McCrindle's research specialist and media specialist, Anna Colthorpe. Anna, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Thanks for having me again.
I just stuffed up your title there. So your technical title is Media Research Specialist, but prior to you going on a bit of leave, you were definitely in the research space. Now you've kind of come into the Media Research Specialist space. So, and to begin our podcast today, I wondered if you could more eloquently than I just did update our listeners on what your role is at the moment at McCrindle.
Yes, so I am McCrindle's Media Research Specialist. So that involves looking after McCrindle's media releases, as well as helping our clients create media-ready headlines from their projects.
It's amazing. You're doing a fantastic job. Ever since you've been in this role, you have been just kicking goals. We're seeing so many more media mentions. It's a role that I have done in the past, and it's just amazing to see how you've transformed it. But before we delve into a little bit of the how you're able to do this and how research can help organizations get cut through with their PR and, you know, using research in that regard, I wondered if you could just divulge to our listeners one research project that comes to mind or stands out to you that did receive great cut through in the media.
Yeah, so with all of our media releases and things we generate from our research desk here at McCrindle, we've found that journalists love projects and insights that are new and fresh and that give their story or piece an exclusive element. So one particular project I love that we generate is our annual baby names report, which gets great cut through in the media each year. And journalists just love reporting on the top baby names for each year. And it's something we love developing because it's a fabulous generational marker for the top baby names of that year. And another project that comes to mind of recent interest, which got great cut through, was our project with Insignia Financial. And this project, our research team worked together with Insignia Financial and developed the Financial Freedom Index, uncovering the financial aspirations of modern Australia today. And amongst other insights from the project, we found that the Great Australian Dream is no longer the top aspiration for Australians today, but instead financial independence. So really interesting insights there.
Absolutely. Yeah, some really amazing research and reports, and you've been instrumental in our baby names report over the last few years. And your previous debut on the podcast actually was about our baby names report from last year. So yeah, it's such great research that you're working on, that you're helping our clients get cut through on. For me, and when I think about research that we've conducted that have helped a client kind of go to media or go to market is the Helga's Kindness Index, if you recall that one. And it was this really cool kind of piece of research for Helga's Bakehouse, who do Helga's bread. And we did and investigated all these insights about how often Australians perform acts of kindness. And they went out to media with that. And of course, they get a lot of brand mentions when the media run that research, but they also get to be considered thought leaders in that space. And it's cool that that brand wanted to be known for being kind and linking that to their sales and of their products. So it's really cool. It's a cool journey to kind of go on from that initial brief that we get or that you might get from a client around, this is our product, this is our marketing strategy, but we want some statistics and figures to kind of bring that to life and to show them as thought leaders in that. So it's really cool space to be working in. And like you said, we get to see some real tangible results from these kinds of insights when you see the research in the media, whether it's on TV or on the radio or in print. It's very rewarding. So great work on all of that. And so let's delve into a little bit of the how you're able to achieve such fantastic results in this area. So we know that research has long been a cornerstone of informed decision making, and that its role in PR or public relations is becoming more significant than ever before. From your perspective, Anne, how do you see research as transforming the landscape of PR, and why do you think it's more relevant now than ever before?
Yeah, well, as you mentioned, there in today's age, there are so many social platforms, media outlets, blogs, podcasts, online news forums, all filled with multiple people. Sorry, I might just start it again. Yes, so as you mentioned, Ash, there's so many information out there. In today's age, there are multiple social platforms, media outlets, blogs, podcasts, and online news forums, all filled with multiple people's thoughts, views, opinions, based off of a multitude of things like experiences, their own reflections, and things they've learned. And in that alone, there's so much information there, and a lot of that is valid, but with an increased immersion of today's society in amongst so much information, it's becoming imperative to have credible information and research to back up your topic and cut through the noise and sources. And because of this incredible amount of information available to journalists, media outlets are at a particularly interesting advantage where they can practically choose what they'd like to report on instead of searching for it themselves. They've given so much information on a platter to choose what will be the most interesting and cut through all the other information and noise out there. So including research is important as it ensures your content will be credible and allow it to cut through all of that and engage readers with a research-backed and plausible data, which is paramount for lending authority to the message that you're delivering.
Yeah, it's so true. I think sometimes in our presentations to clients, we'll talk about, you know, words of the year from the last decade. And some of those words are around post-truth and fake news and just the rise of, like you said, so many social media platforms where anyone can put out information and content. But now I feel like because of that, the media is playing this really unique role where they're actually very trusted and credible. And like you said, Anne, to be able to have evidence-based insights to fuel those stories is more important than ever in an era of fake news where everyone can jump on and influencers can say whatever they like to millions of followers. Like the media, the mainstream media, whether that's TV or radio or print or online or even trusted news sources through social media, need to have some of that evidence backing, which we love to, again, play a role in that. And I also think about, I guess, like you said, with the message saturated media environment that we all are living in, there's so much more power with the consumer. And Luke Davies and I touched on this in our Future of Marketing podcast episode a few episodes ago, where I feel like for an organization, marketing and advertising is pretty hard these days, like to get cut through with your message. And so to have new research or insights that give insight into the population or whatever it might be is a great way to, by, I guess, as a byproduct of that, get organizations, brands into the conversation. If they say, you know, Helga's commissioned XYZ, and then it's not, Helga's is not the focus. The kindness index is in the example I gave earlier, but Helga's get a mention, and that's really valuable to them. So yeah, really important work that you're doing. And you're on the front foot with that because you're working through the questions that are going to get cut through to run in a survey, but you're also hearing those client needs. Do you feel like that's what I've said is an accurate depiction of what you're hearing from clients?
Yes, absolutely. I think it's important, and important to them that they already recognize that themselves, trying to find that message that stands out. And as you mentioned, the Helgas, they've got an idea and used it to leverage their brand. And I think it's fantastic because in things like that, they're able to touch on the ethos of their organization as well at the same time. So yeah, it's fantastic space to be in.
And that's so important, and more important than ever, I think, for younger generations as well, who are looking to not just what is this product and is it a good product, but what's the brand's, like you said, ethos, what's their stance on sustainability, what's their ethics. There's a lot more that goes into the consumer decision today than just what's the price of this product that I like. So all of that is to say research is very helpful in that. And a big part of that that you work so well in, Anna, is, I guess, turning numbers into compelling narratives. Like there's one part of it to, you know, run a research project or ask, you know, like ask good questions, but then turning that into something the media is going to absorb and turning it into a story effectively is a key role that you play, and you do it very well, and it holds immense potential for organizations who can actually have those skills and, you know, do that well. So I wondered, Anne, if you could walk our listeners and me through the the thought process behind how you go about, say, selecting these stories or particular, you know, things that are actually going to get cut through or statistics that will have an impact on, say, shaping public perception and driving conversations.
Yes, of course. So when looking for a headline amongst the data, we're looking for a couple of things. We're looking for anything that is new or noteworthy. For example, we discovered that young generations turn to social platforms to teach themselves new things. And the story there that we found was that almost half of Gen Z turn to TikTok and Instagram on a daily basis to learn something new. And this is a fresh insight and also a comparable of the times we're in with these social platforms holding such prominence in their lives. We're also looking for something that might have changed with significance. For example, a project that comes to mind, and the one I mentioned earlier in our conversation around the new financial dream for young Australians, what was once a dream of owning the home, a great Australian dream, has changed, and that's significant. This is interesting as the Australian dream continues to evolve. This is interesting as the Australian dream continues to evolve and is another generational marker of the times we're in, with rising house prices, in some cases locking young generations out of the housing market. And so as a result, the new financial dream is financial independence. And another thing we're looking for is to report on trends, particularly those that align with the culture we're in. So one study that comes to mind is that 1 in 4 Aussies can't survive the day without coffee, and 1 in 3 Australians purchase their coffee from a cafe. And this was particularly interesting because it was young Aussies who are most likely to purchase a coffee from a cafe, which highlights today's cafe culture among young Australians getting out there and using the cafes as their social network and community.
Yeah, there's some really great examples there, I think, Anne. And yeah, what you mentioned is so important around it being like newsworthy. I think there's been, of course, times in my tenure here when I was even in this role where I'm like, oh, this research is so interesting. It's so fun. The media are going to eat it up. And then it just, no one picks it up. And you're like, oh, why? Like, there's no certainties and guarantees in media, which can be frustrating at times. But it has to be something that, you know, the audience think are relevant. And so even, I guess, a part of yours and my role is as well, is trying to keep a pulse on what people think, which I think also has a benefit to clients who, instead of just running a survey themselves, they actually, you know, engage a third party organization like, say, a research company like us, which lends further credibility to their piece and can add a little bit of objectivity. Because again, the media, and even for me, you know, as a consumer of media, when someone's pushing a product at you, it's like too much of an ad. Whereas when there's like new research, I'm like, oh, this is interesting. And yes, it was commissioned by XYZ brand, but it's still got relevance, you know, to me or to my life or to something that's quite interesting. I mean, at the moment, we're finding a lot of content that we put out around cost of living or living pressures is getting cut through because it's so relevant and it's so topical. So having that relevancy, I think, is really important. And everyone loves to talk about, you know, like you said, house prices. Everyone can relate to it. So those wider spread things are also, I think, the topics that most people are going to engage with or they find interesting, like baby names, like coffee, like house prices. We often see those kinds of topics getting good cut through, which is really cool. Part of what you do and a really, I guess, key part of getting cut through in this area is crafting strong and engaging media releases with key stories that, you know, hold important data but communicated in an engaging way that a journalist is going to pick up. I wondered if you could, if you have any reflections on, I guess, this process behind what stories you select or how you craft a media release and how you kind of shape that so that it will get cut through when you're sending it out to journalists. Do you have any reflections on how you do that?
Yeah, well, as you just mentioned, Ash, just about the up-to-date and fresh data, and that's one of my favourite things about the research and what we do is that we're asking Australians or people on their thoughts, views and sentiments, and there's nothing like that fresh and up-to-date data, which is so relevant for the conversations we're having in the media landscape, and nothing more better. That's the worst way to say it. There's nothing more better. I'll go from there. There is nothing like that fresh and up-to-date data, which is so relevant for the conversations we're having in the media landscape than this recent public perception. And this is exactly the perception I take into selecting the stories. What's resonating with the media at the moment? For example, we wouldn't go out in July for things about Christmas. Mm-hmm. That might be a no-brainer, but we are always on the pulse with other Australians. We've got pulse on other projects we're doing internally as well. Not that we can always use the data, but we do have a bit of insight into some of the things that Australians might be thinking and feeling, which we can also have that as a foundation for why we select stories. And we use this to help inform leaders in the public. What do leaders need to know of Australians' views? How will what we've shared help shape decisions or help inform decision makers on their perceptions? And the impact of this is immeasurable because it allows these fresh insights to be included in the conversation so that the messaging is aligned to the current public perception.
Yeah, some really great insights there, Anne. And I know you and I will, edit a media release together, and even the importance of like a really good title, because I think, the next question I have for you is leaning on something we talked about earlier, just around, in a world where there's more information than ever before, where everyone's got really short attention spans, credibility is important, but also like simplicity of message. And I often, when I'm training someone in this area or reflecting on the learnings that I have with working with journalists and media and PR, it's about almost doing the work for the journalist. And that's our role, of course, as researchers. We get the data back, we have to analyze it, we have to pull out the story, we have to look at all the crosstabs and go, well, what's the unique point of information? What's the story here? Like, we're trying to delve into that and then bring it to life, but using, as less like really short, sharp sentences. We don't want super long paragraphs. We've got to have quotes. We've got to, do all of that. So, and I wondered if you could just elaborate, if you have any further thoughts on how we do this and how the fact that when we do incorporate data and insights into these media releases, into these stories, into these PR campaigns, how it kind of addresses skepticism that people might hold about credibility or information, how it builds trust, and how it might also distinguish a campaign, because the media landscape is very crowded. So how do you feel like a research-informed data campaign actually helps that campaign to stand out?
Yes, and like we talked about, the amount of information available to journalists, there's so much of it, including that data and that fresh insights helps elevate the message when they're included. And because research-based messaging it reduces the skepticism in the media. So take Google, for example. You put a topic in the search bar and literally a million results pop up. How do people know that what a journalist is providing is, trustworthy? When data is included, it gives that credible hand to the message and the topic that the journalist is writing about. And even TikTok as another example for the younger generations. I can go onto my For You page or the feed, and you can see one topic and one person's opinion, and then you can see literally right after it a completely different view. So adding that research is important to make sure that the journalist is presenting with a reputable source. Sorry about all the stuff up.
No, you're right. No problem. Okay.
I can't remember what I was saying. Uh,
TikTok and For You page, the importance of data, reputable sources are more important than ever.
Yeah.
I think.
Okay. Anyway, I'll leave that. And then, so it's when I get off my notes, I've lost my point. Okay.
Yeah, no, it's hard when you've got good things to say and you're like, where was I at?
Okay, here we go. So by engaging a research agency like McCrindle, we can bring some foundational research which gives your PR campaign legs to stand on, giving authority to your message and helping it stand out amongst the vast amounts of information available for consumers today.
Yeah, it's so important. And I mean, I think about, yeah, TikTok and just even how, and I feel like I was rebuked the other day. Like I think I was talking to another colleague of ours and we were talking about a perspective on like the Barbie movie or something. And I was like, oh, it's interesting to see like even just the social validation on TikTok about the number of likes or the number of people that have engaged with something kind of to me signals, oh, it's resonating with people. And that might be true, but I saw something the other day that kind of challenged me on this, where I saw a video and it had so many likes, like over 500,000 or something. And I was looking at the content and I was like, this isn't actually right. And all the comments were like, is this actually factual? Like a lot of people were questioning it, but it's still on face value had like 500,000 likes. So like for that social proof, I was like, oh yeah, this must be legit. But then when I actually thought about it, I was like, no. And so even in that context for journalists, again, I feel like they just have this really unique ability to provide truth in that. And like you said, like anything with a statistic, again, we shouldn't just, if there's a stat, we shouldn't just go, oh, that's correct. Like, and people question us on stats and we love that. They should question the integrity of the data. But again, when an organization does engage a third party research company who specializes in this, there is that assumed, I think appropriately assumed level of credibility that, you know, that research company might be bringing to a campaign rather than just a company coming out and saying X percent of people love this and we have this product, so come buy it. Like it's actually when we engage with McCrindle, they found this. And so then insert, you know, brand proposition or whatever it might be. So I think it's increasingly relevant. It's increasingly important. And yeah, finding truth in this world is pretty hard in the media landscape today. And so if we can play, you know, a role in that, and that's what one of our like purpose statements is around promoting truth, wisdom and beauty. And for us, it's about finding the research and the truth and the data, but communicating it in a way that has wisdom and is also beautiful, where it's visual and it cuts through and it's engaging rather than just kind of great stats that sit locked away because they look too dense or too data heavy. So we work very hard, you work very hard at communicating on behalf of our clients, you know, their story and helping data to lift and elevate that. And again, a key part of that, like we've mentioned, is just understanding the current context and understanding what's resonating with people, understanding the sentiment and the needs of, you know, a target audience is really important for any kind of communication, but also especially for media. And I'd be keen to hear how you think insights, you know, that we glean from PR or from data that helps PR professionals tailor their message, how that fosters a sense of reliability. Do you feel like from the feedback we've gained from clients we've worked with that, you know, their feedback is, oh yeah, this data was really helpful. It helped us to, again, foster that sense of reliability and trust and drive engagement. Do you feel like there's a correlation there with when research is included in a campaign?
Yes, definitely. Yeah. We find that when we're developing or helping particularly PR agencies develop a campaign, it's most effective and cut through when it's directly aligned to the needs of the audience or the consumer, Australian consumer. When people's sentiments are captured and after capturing data, which is representative of Australians, PR professionals that they can ensure their messaging meets the needs of the media landscape as the audience will be able to relate to the data that we've presented and resonate with it. And so that alone increases trust and drives engagement of the message and allows buy-in from the audience and fosters reliability to the message conveying. And like you mentioned, Ash, about things that you don't resonate with, something came up on TikTok and it was about how to get the mortgage down by a little tweak, and it just created so much buzz on TikTok and it was incorrect, and that alone created buzz from other mortgage brokers and everything. Everyone just got on board. It was so interesting to see because it ticked a couple of boxes. It resonated with the Australian public of, I want to get my mortgage repayments down, but it wasn't actually accurate. So it's kind of like that correlation of resonating, being in tune with the times, but as well as having that accurate and credible data to back it up. It just, those two things together can make a messaging sing, really.
Yeah, and it's not to discourage anyone, you know, working in PR or media, because we know this, like I mentioned with an example earlier, where you think you've got the perfect storm and everything's curated and it's planned, and then it doesn't get the kind of cut through. Or the inverse of, like you said, where organizations see something relevant in the media and then like that fake mortgage broker thing. I'm pretty sure someone even in my life was like, hey, Ash, like, have you heard about this mortgage hack? And I was like, this does not sound legit. And yes, turns out it wasn't. But then all the legit people who have real credible advice come out and say, well, let's jump on the news train of the relevance of this. And that's where, again, quick, because that's part of what we do, and that's what part of you do as well, Anne, is what we call an omnibus, where we might run, you know, a survey to a nationally representative sample of Australians. We can turn that around really quickly, because when an organization wants relevance, you've got to jump on things really quick. It's got to be sharp and turn around. I mean, media expect a lot and they move on quite quickly. So the timing of these campaigns, being able to turn it around really quickly, we know all of the value of that, and you do that so well for our clients. So it's not an easy role. There's never a predictable outcome, but I think, like we've talked about in the podcast today, there are a lot of ingredients in this mix that we know, and that we know are tried and trusted and tested, and that you do so well, that we love to help organizations with. And I think for us at McCrindle, we run so many different research studies. We run a lot that is confidential and private to the organizations that commission it, and that is purposeful and impactful at a board level or a strategic senior management level. But then there's these insights that kind of go far and wide, that kind of get to shape the landscape and the media in a broader way, which we love to do as well, and which you've done so many times so well for our clients. So thank you so much for coming on the podcast today, Anne, and for all your amazing work in this media research specialist space.
Oh, thanks, Ash. Thanks for having me. And yes, definitely couldn't do it without the team and your help, and love bouncing those ideas off you. So it's great. Thanks.
It's so fun. And a lot of the research that we actually get to talk about on the podcast is public facing, and it comes from our research that is public and goes to the media. So a lot of what our listeners hear is actually driven by you, or you've touched it at some point, and someone else might be coming on to talk about it if it's not relating to a specific client or a project. So thanks for also fueling a lot of the research we get to talk about on the podcast, like the coffee and the tattoos one we just did with Sophie recently. So it's so much fun. And if anyone is out there listening to this podcast who's got questions about media or running a campaign, please get in touch. You'll probably be talking to Anne or someone else from our team about how we can help. But also, if you'd like to stay up to date with our latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com to find out more about our PR research advisory services, but also just the incredible stats that we glean from said research. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.